Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.
Hi, welcome to another edition of Centering on Peace. My name is Faramarz Farbod, and I teach political science at Moravian College. Centering on Peace is brought to you on second Tuesdays of every month by Berks Peace County, Peace Community, sorry, with the great help of BCTV. Tonight, my subject is a conversation with historian Howard Zinn's Marx in Soho actor, Robert Weick, and it's being recorded on Thursday, January 6th, about 5 days before it will be broadcast on BCTV. And the subject is going to be about Howard Zinn, his performance on Marx in Soho. It's a one-man play, and we're going to deal with, you know, radical ideas as well, whether maligned or praised, Karl Marx has been misrepresented and distorted. Indeed, proclaimed dead too by the powers that be and their spokespeople. But my guest tonight has traveled the nation and internationally too to set the record straight. He has done that via the production of Marx in Soho, a one-person play written by the late beloved historian, playwright, socialist, and social activist Howard Zinn. Most recently, Bob celebrated the 200th anniversary of Marx's birthday in 2018 by going on a national and international tour of the play, beginning in 2017, I believe. And of course, he had been performing the play before that, perhaps over 300 times, if I'm not mistaken. He would probably know the number himself. And unfortunately, the pandemic put a stop, I think, to his wonderful performance. And we hope that someday soon he will return to that. Now, well, this is Bob Weick. He's a former resident of Lehigh Valley. And he's been kind enough to accept my invitation to be the guest of this program tonight. Welcome to Centering on Peace, Bob.
Oh, well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here and to have the opportunity to speak with you again, Farah. It's been a while since we've seen each other. I think the last time I saw you was at the Ice House in Bethlehem.
Yes,
right?
It was.
We had a special performance there of Marx in Soho, and it was a great night, a packed house.
Exactly.
It was a wonderful, wonderful evening. So yeah, it's good to see you again.
Yes.
And it's great to be part of this program.
Yes, it was, I think, September 2018.
Yeah,
when you appeared in the Ice House and we had a nice pack house. Wonderful. And I love the picture on the wall up there that you have.
Oh, yeah.
Tell us what that is.
Well, right. You know, as I travel around the country, all the different venues often create posters to commemorate or to announce that the event is coming. And so there's a collection of different ones, and within that frame, the original one in the back was the one from the original production in Philadelphia in 2004. Was the first time I stepped on stage to play Marx. And the original poster designed by John Doyle, who also directed the play, we sent a copy to Howard and sent a few extra to Howard. He was kind enough to sign them and include his comments. He really loved our production. Different actors have done this play over the years, and Howard particularly liked the Iron Age Theater production. And so back from 2004, he said to me and he said to John, you know, he encouraged us to take this play wherever we could across the country. Felt like a commission from Howard. It was fascinating to bring this play to people and see the reaction and how people engaged with it and enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. So he asked us to please take it across the country, perform it wherever we could. And the interesting thing about that is he did not want any royalties for it. Mm. He just, you know, he knew it was an expensive thing to be an actor and to travel and to have to do all these things. And I once said, you know, Howard, you know, would it be all right if I charge people for my time? And Howard's like, well, you know, Bob, Lefty's got to eat too. So he was terrific about that. And and I had the pleasure over the years to travel with Howard and to perform, to appear with him in venues in Boston and LA. And it's, you know, that was just one of the wonderful things to get to know Howard as well.
But when you do perform Marx in Soho, doesn't it, a portion of the revenues go to his estate?
Well, it does now. With Howard's passing, I had to make a new agreement with the executors of his estate. So they get a portion of the proceeds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that was not... That was alive, but after...
When Howard was alive, he just said, you go, Bob, just keep going, you know? And I would send him reviews or send him clips, and we would chat, we would talk. We actually made some changes to the script that he approved of, made some edits. We updated some things. We add lines about the environment, which were not part of the original script. So it was wonderful to work with Howard. He was such a generous spirit. Genuinely kind and funny and generous. Terrific guy.
Yeah, excellent. And the changes that you said you made, I remember... the one time that I brought you to Moravian College to perform many years ago.
Yeah, maybe that's 10 years ago now. Maybe.
10 years ago before the 2018 one that we were discussing earlier. I think it was after that, or maybe it was after 2018 that we met afterwards, and we dined together and we discussed a bit of the changes about conceptions of human nature. In some of the performance, the words that you were going to say, and I think you made that change anyway with some permission. You got Gary Olson involved in terms of his writings about empathy and stuff like that may have changed something in the performance,
and I it's hard for me now to remember what was the original script and what it is I do now. I do remember that we did the environmental things, but I remember the conversation about human nature. Because what we're often hit with, right? It's a question that comes up a lot. But somehow that capitalism is natural to us, and the idea of cooperation and sharing and equality are somehow foreign to us as creatures. And so it is one of those topics that comes up quite often.
You need to be prepared. Q&As with, you know, some of the people might raise that with you, especially in North America.
Right.
I would imagine. So we'll get to that a little bit later, I think. But because we're at the beginning of our conversation, I wanted you to just speak a little bit about yourself, where you grew up, your family's background, your upbringing, you know, what you did for a living before you made it into the stage and played Marx in Soho and other plays.
Sure. I grew up in the nation's poorest large city of Philadelphia, working class Kensington section of Philadelphia, which is notorious now for its tragic drug overdose cases.
Brotherly love, city of brotherly love.
City of brotherly love. I forget to celebrate that about Philadelphia because it doesn't feel that way quite often. It's a wonderful city. I do a lot of theater there and there. My roots are there, and there's so much that I do appreciate about the city, but we shouldn't deny the problems that exist there as well. I grew up poor, working class. My father worked on the docks along the Delaware River. I'm one of nine siblings. We were good Irish Catholics. And so my mother was obviously had her hands full and stayed at home. Took care of nine children in a little row house in Kensington.
Which of the siblings you were, how many before and
I was the second born. I'm now the eldest. My older brother Tom died actually quite young, in his 40s. So I am now the oldest in the family. And you know, we had aunts who were nuns and uncles who were priests in the Catholic Church. I was an altar boy. I was tagged for the priesthood at one point, thought that that might be a path that I'd go on. But that didn't happen. I ended up the big sport in my neighborhood, because it was such an ethnic neighborhood. You had the Irish neighborhood, new Polish neighborhood, new Scottish neighborhood. My neighbors were from Scotland. I began to play soccer. All my brothers did. Everyone in the neighborhood did.
It was soccer. Hey, I'm a soccer player.
Yeah. All right. So, you know, it's the beautiful game.
Beautiful
and,
game.
And so, but this is 1960s America, where it really isn't on the radar, except in your ethnic neighborhoods and your inner cities.
Yeah. By the way, what position did you play in soccer?
I played center half and sweeper back. Yeah.
Okay, me too. Center back. Center back and sometimes defense. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So, what this did for us is that because we were developed into very solid players, and because the universities were now developing their collegiate programs, I was able to get a full athletic scholarship to attend Lehigh University. That's what brought me to the Lehigh Valley. I played soccer for 4 years there. I was captain of the team, got the MVP award, all those things. And I continued to play after.
And what year was that? What year was that you entered Lehigh
University? So I graduated from high school in 73.
Okay.
And so that fall of 73 was my first season with Lehigh. Started as a freshman, played all four seasons, started every game, my 4 years there. Mm-hmm. We did not win championships. There were too many smart guys. We needed more city kids on that team. But that's my roots. It's down there. And I think as far as my parents, it was not a political household. It wasn't a literary household. Neither of my parents had attended college.
Okay.
My father enjoyed history. Especially around the war, because he was born in 1929, mm-hmm. and the World War II years were very formative for him. Mm-hmm. He was in the army for a while, served in Korea, came back, and his work. He was also a talented musician and singer. I didn't start out in the performing arts, but I mm-hmm. sometimes think that being exposed to his music, and I would sometimes go along and I would drum, I could drum, I'd be the drummer, was maybe set the stages, because I did not start acting until later in life, till the age of 40.
Okay.
Prior to that, I had been working as a farrier, a blacksmith. I continue to this day to shoe horses. Now I do it on a part-time basis.
You could make a living like that?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, you can make a good living at it. A horse, there are so many horses around and they all need good hoof care. Mm-hmm. That old saying of no hoof, no horse is still true today. Mm-hmm. So if you're a skillful farrier, you can make a very nice living. And I did that for a long time mm-hmm. and still do it.
So what happened that around age 40, you made this transition to performing?
Yeah. Art? Well, oddly, it was a loss of my Christian faith was part of it, because part of my outlet that I had started singing for the church choir and mm-hmm. ended up leaving the church.
Wow.
And then looking for some outlet, and I joined the Bucks County choral group and was singing with them. And it was that chorus director, Donna Paris, God rest her soul, Donna Paris, who said to me, you know, you should try musical theater sometime. And sure enough, the next day there were auditions in the paper for a production in New Jersey of Jesus Christ Superstar. Now, the thing that's interesting about that, because I had uncles who were priests, and at the time there was a very strong radical left presence in the Catholic Church. Now, Jesus Christ Superstar was condemned by the Catholic Church.
Oh, it was.
It was condemned, but which did nothing but sell a lot of tickets. And my uncle actually bought me a copy of the album. He said, Bob, anything that makes you think about your faith is fine, you know, enjoy the music, you know, it's great. So when the audition came around, I knew it inside and out. I knew it, and they ended up casting me as one of them.
Can we get the Catholic Church to condemn Marx and Soho's performance? So,
yeah, I'm waiting for that. It hasn't happened yet, but that would help ticket sales.
That's right.
But, you know, I did this play for the nuns, the Catholic workers in Elizabeth, New Jersey. Mm-hmm. I've done this play for all sorts of audiences, and I'm sure we'll get to it later. But it was fascinating to do this play. And Marx, you know, is an atheist. And at one point during the play, and I have a room full of sisters, wonderful audience. At one point, Marx says during the play, directly to the audience, like, I know Jesus. He's not coming back.
And they all sat there. That.
Yeah, right.
I've seen you do it three times, three performances.
Right, right. Okay. Not coming back, you know. And I deliver that line differently depending on the audience. Because sometimes it's like, he's not coming back, and, you know, exasperation. But with the sisters, I said, I know. He's not coming back. You know, I was trying to be like solicitous of their feelings.
Exactly.
And they come up to speak to me at the end of the play, and they're like, oh, you know, I love this and I love that, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, they've got Dorothy Day in their bones, you know, so they're right with Marx.
And I'm pretty certain, those are Howard Zinn's version of Marx saying that. I can't imagine Marx saying it with this humorous, you know, language, but Howard, any day.
Yeah, he would. He's not quoting Marx directly.
Marx would be somber. That's much more somber. Maybe that's a stereotype, but
yeah, it could be. But you know, Nunn said, we loved everything about the play, but he is coming back, they told me. Okay. I said, sisters, I hope you're right.
But you know, you don't just let Marx be channeled through you in the play, Marx in Soho. Yeah. You consider yourself to be a radical and a socialist.
Yeah.
And so I suppose my question would be, still going back to your background, anything in your upbringing, anything in your experiences late in life, middle age type, you know, period, that led you to take this provocative, seemingly provocative turn in your life, to turn towards radicalism? Yeah.
My own journey towards, I self-identify as a revolutionary socialist.
Mm-hmm.
My own journey towards it is one that in some ways gives me hope for the future, because I did not start out as a red diaper baby.
Mm-hmm.
My parents weren't particularly political. But there was the controversy of the Vietnam War when I was a young man.
Okay.
And right before they eliminated the draft, I was coming up on my 18th birthday. Mm-hmm. And I had watched nuns and priests and the Bergen brothers and the controversy around the war and the protests mm-hmm. around the war. I remember being enthralled with Muhammad Ali and his choice not to go. And of course, now Muhammad Ali is going to fight Joe Frazier, and I'm from Philadelphia, and Joe Frazier's from Philadelphia, and all my friends and even my brothers and my father, they're voting for George Frazier because they want to see Muhammad Ali get beat up because of his anti-war stance. And I'm like, no, I don't know.
Even your father?
My father too. He was.
What kind of a history was he reading?
oh yes, well that's a good question, right?
Not Howard Zinn's People's History.
Was not reading Howard Zinn. It wasn't published yet. Was part of the problem. Howard Zinn was too busy at the anti-war protest to write books at the time.
Did you ever have a chance to give a copy of that to your dad? Was he around?
He died like 10 years ago. My one conversation with my father about it, you know, he came to the play and he. Because he was supportive of me as an actor, mm-hmm. and but he's like, Bob, I don't know. Didn't I go to war to stop this guy? You know, I said, well, Dad, you know. He said, but anyway, that was great. And he just, you know, a lot of times they got off the topic,
mm-hmm.
you know, because it was a foreign language to them, which is why the play is so successful. Why mm-hmm. I take it to universities and communities, because people have either no view or this distorted view of who Karl Marx was.
Yeah,
you know.
So I
didn't grow up in a politically active household, but I did grow up sort of in Philadelphia. The Democratic Party had its machine. Mm-hmm. If my father got a parking ticket, we could take it to the local councilman. Mm-hmm. The parking ticket would get fixed, and you knew that you would vote Democratic. It was very, you know, like all politics, it's very corrupt. Mm-hmm. And that was the power structure there. And so I grew up with...
corrupt and local.
with local corruption and with... And I just want to add, and the sort of the gospel of Jesus in the sense of, you know, the Acts of the Apostles, mm-hmm. right? Of the idea of the community, of the idea of sharing, that, you know, that there's a problem with the rich man, because that rich man, for all his money, can't get into heaven. He's got a better chance of going through the eye of the needle. So some of these, all of these things were there and present in my life, but I was not a politically active young person, but I would say that when I did vote, I voted for the Democratic Party.
Mm-hmm. You were saying the influence of Vietnam War era. So you were not active at all or interested in politics during the war years?
Well,
pretty long, many years.
I was interested, but I was young. I was a little too young for it, right? So at the height of the war, I was 12 years old, mm-hmm. right? And in 1967, I was 12. I was born in 55. Mm-hmm. So even in 1970, I'm only 15 years old.
I see.
And it was not a part of the household discussion, but enough of it had influenced me that I knew it was a problem. I'd seen news reports, but it wasn't something that we did as a family or that I engaged in all that much. Like a lot of young people, I was involved in my soccer career and my girlfriends and my siblings, and all that was something that was more theoretical than real. It didn't touch, mm-hmm. it didn't touch my life.
I see.
Yeah. So, although I think, you know, as I reflect back, I think it did put me that my roots put me in a certain position as a progressive Democrat.
Yeah, and that's some of the Christian beliefs that you're discussing here. It's interesting that you didn't move in the direction of liberation theology and still retained a Christian framework of looking at the world, but you moved towards the direction of revolutionary socialism and I believe those atheistic directions, right?
Yeah, and that evolved over time. I mean, actually, I started to lose my faith long before I started to perform the play. I really wanted to believe, and I tried really hard. And I had one summer where I actually, because as a Catholic, you're not encouraged to read the Bible. They just explain everything to you, and they give you a catechism. I decided to read the Bible cover to cover one summer. That was the end of my faith.
You did read it cover to cover.
Yeah. And that was kind of the end of it. I just found like I didn't like this guy or this God. You know, I didn't, you know, there were, of course, aspects of the New Testament and even some beautiful poetic aspects of the Old Testament that I could appreciate. But it just felt like the faith of my faith was destroyed. I kind of went to read it to restore it and it had the opposite effect. I couldn't do it. Mm-hmm. So, and that was before I began to do the play in 2004.
Now, for those of you who, I'm talking to the audience who've just joined us, I'm having a conversation here with Robert Weick. He's an actor. He performs a one-person play called Marx in Soho, written by the beloved historian, radical social activist, Howard Zinn. So, go ahead.
Yeah, where was I?
So I got my own talking about, you know, 2004 when you began performing. Yeah. And maybe it's a good moment here to say in 2004, just briefly go over how did you end up meeting Howard Zinn and ending up actually persuading him or he persuading you that you ought to be doing this?
All right. So the story, so I ended up doing this musical called Jesus Christ Superstar. Opening night came and I was terrified, but by the end of the run, I had the bug. I really enjoyed it. The same theater company offered me a role in their next production in which I played Linus and You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, an all adult cast, another musical. And I just kind of got the bug and I was going, and then I'd go to another audition and I'd be cast and I'd go to another audition and I'd be cast. And I eventually ended up in the Lehigh Valley working with George Miller and Kate Scuffle at the Theater Outlet.
I do know that.
Right. Wonderful people who did a lot of important theater, controversial theater at the time. Plays like The Laramie Project. You know,
one of them died recently.
George, dear friend of mine.
Yeah, that's terrible. A few months ago. That was so sad.
Yeah, he's wonderful. And I was honored to be able to speak at his service. But George and Kate and the Theater Outlet began this transformation for me where theater was no longer something that you just went and did for fun, but where you could really affect society by telling stories. It's a classic storytelling and the power of art to speak to a part of ourselves that reading the book or listening to a lecture, no matter how gifted the professor, you know, it's the arts speak to a different part of our humanity, right?
Yeah.
Which is why professors will sometimes bring the play to campus because it connects with the students a different way, different way in. And I saw
art,
the power
art for the people.
Yes, for the people. Yeah.
Oh, you need those things. Science for the people, art for the people, politics for the people.
Right. By the people.
And by the people.
Yes. So. Yeah, so, and while I was there performing, a gentleman named Dick Nepon, mm-hmm. Was a resident of Lehigh Valley, gave me a copy of Marx and Soho. I'd never heard of it. He said, "Here, Bob, take this and read it. I think this would be a great role for you." And I've told this story before. The first time I opened that up and I saw that it was a one-man play, I went, "Oh, geez, no!" I put that book right down because I was a relatively novice actor, mm-hmm. even though I was 40 years old. And the idea of stepping out stage all by myself, memorizing a small book, and going out and delivering it verbatim in front of people was too intimidating of an idea. But as you'll recall at this time, it's the year 2000, 9/11 happens.
Hmm.
And now we're getting to be, we're in the midst of the Bush years, and we're in Afghanistan, and there's a buildup to the Iraq War.
Mm-hmm.
And we're at home, you know, we're now members of the POCO, right? The wonderful mm-hmm. peace organization. Mm-hmm. And we're actively protesting the war. Mm-hmm. And I take that book off the shelf. And I have to admit that at the time, I'm not a Marxist. There's things in here I don't understand, but there feels like there's something profoundly true that this is something, as an actor, I can do more than stand on the corner. I mm-hmm. can try to tell this story. And I took it to John Doyle of Iron Age Theater, who, much like Theater Outlet, would engage in controversial, cutting-edge social justice plays in theater. And I had worked with them before, and I brought him the script. I said, "Here's a script I think you guys should produce." And John said, "Well, I'll produce and direct this play if you'll act in it." And we made the deal. And so the September of 2004, I produced the play. And part of me, you know, coming from my progressive liberal democratic background, was thinking my motivation was to stop George Bush. Mm-hmm. You know, let's get Kerry in office. Mm-hmm. Like, that would be somehow revolutionary, significantly different. And it might have helped with the war, but probably not.
Evolution of your consciousness.
yeah. And yeah, so an evolution begins, because now I'm performing this play and I'm starting to have to think about, this is my first encounter with Marx, mm-hmm. is through this play.
Wow.
And I realize just how much I don't know. And I'm realizing as I'm reading about it, oh my God, how much of this is true and how much of this resonates and how different our society could be. And oh my God, what have we done?
Mm-hmm.
And then having the positive reaction from Howard, from that production, and professors coming to me in Philadelphia saying, "Would you bring this to campus? This is a great introduction to Marx." You know, he mm-hmm. influences so many academic fields of study.
Exactly. Did Howard found out about you, or did you go to him?
So no, I had to go to him. So when I get the script and I read it, we decide to do it, I contact South End Press, who's a publisher. This mm-hmm. is what usually happens, and I would deal with the publisher.
Michael Alberts. South End Press was put out by Michael Abbott and Z.
Oh, right. Z-Net. So I thought I was going to have to deal with someone there and pay them royalties and they would arrange it. Mm-hmm. They said, "You have to talk to Howard Zinn directly." Mm-hmm. And I was a little intimidated by this whole prospect, you know, because I, you know, at this point I had been reading people's history and all that. So I was like, "Dear Professor Howard Zinn, sir, you know, it's no problem. Sorry to bother you. I'd like to do this play." And I sent off this email and he replied immediately. Mm-hmm. And said, "Bob, yeah, just send me a headshot, your resume, a little audition piece, and we'll take it from there." And he saw that I was a legitimate actor, and he mm-hmm. gave me permission, but he said, I want you to film it. I want you to send it to me." And so we did, and we sent him that copy, and that's why he was thrilled with it. His wife, Roz, was a particular fan of our production. Mm-hmm. She was very kind in her words as well. And that's how I got started. And then over the course of the years, my politics, my understanding has deepened. And the point I like to make here about this is that we in our society, we're really struggling to build a revolutionary left. Mm-hmm. We're really struggling to confront capitalism with the significant numbers of people. And it's so often so hard on social media when I talk with liberals, or let alone conservatives, about the need for a new approach.
Mm-hmm.
A need to break with the power structure of the Democratic Party. As I get so frustrated, and people say, "Well, you got to talk to the young people," and I think there's truth to that. But I like to hold my own evolution from Democrat to progressive to anti-war, liberal progressive to social Democrat to revolutionary socialist. Mm-hmm. With a deepening of knowledge and understanding, this is a progression that can happen no matter how old you are. if you are willing to engage with these ideas.
Yep. That is the takeaway from listening to you. It doesn't matter how old you are, encountering Marx and those radical ideas can have great influence on.
Yeah, that's right. Because what I find
not just understanding of the world, but differently being in the world. Being in the world in a different way, relating to people and to institutions, to nature, to everyone.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Never too late.
No. So, I find that universally, most people don't, you know, they hear Marx and they think Stalin. They hear Marx and they think bread lines. They hear Marx and they think gray, ugly buildings and everyone's cold.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's an interesting moment that you're engaged in these sort of performances, you know, the pandemic notwithstanding. It's that, Marx, you could say Marx has been liberated from the actually existing socialist states of the 20th century.
Right.
And that liberation from those experiences allows someone like you to kind of reintroduce Marx. The audiences who have not a sufficient distance from that century and what took place in it allows them to rethink Marx in a more serious way, interrogate him, yes, but not dismiss him, not accept the distortions that are often attached to his name and his ideas. I think that that's a very important moment for you and your performance. You're dealing with a different kind of circumstance historically.
Yeah, it's true. We're not in the midst of the Cold War. Yeah. And I think it's also surprising to audiences when they hear Marx condemn what happened in Stalinist Russia.
Mm-hmm.
I think it surprises audiences when they hear Marx say the goal of communism is freedom.
Freedom, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You know, the idea that in capitalism, you're not free. No one's free under capitalist system. You know, it has the illusions of freedom.
Yeah. And the full development of the individual. All individuals, everyone.
Right. Yeah,
maybe it's a good time for me to ask you, in light of what you're saying, that since you began this performance way back 16, 17 years ago, and you've done several hundred of them, you must have had an expectation as you went along, performing in different audiences. Right. And how has those expectations stack up against the actual experiences that you've had encountering hundreds, thousands of people during the performances and the Q&A?
So you're talking about the audience reaction?
Yeah.
Those kind of expectations?
Yeah, and also your own expectation of, you know, I'm going to do this performance.
Mm. Right.
Play, and what do I expect from this activity I'm engaging in? And then years of doing it, you've experienced it enormously. And does the experience and the expectation match, or have you found surprising things in this journey?
Well, I will say that in general terms, it's been immensely rewarding to have the opportunity to know Howard Zinn, to have the opportunity to encounter Marx.
Mm-hmm.
So those are two historic figures that I'm glad to know and be familiar with.
Mm-hmm.
It's been an honor to be able to go across the country and share the story of these, of Marx through the eyes of Howard Zinn.
And you did a tour in England too.
Right. Yes. Yeah. I've been over there too.
That's the only country outside of the United States that you performed.
Right. Yeah. I've been primarily in Manchester and London, touring through England. I've not been able. I thought I was going to be able to make something happen in Germany, but that doesn't happen. And there is still in the works now, though, a tour of China.
China. Okay.
Yes. Wow, I'm still in conversation with people. I met Chinese nationals while performing Marx in Manchester, England. It looks like I may be going back again in the fall to Manchester specifically to perform for those comrades there.
And what is the how was the reception any different in England than the United States, or was it pretty much the same?
I will say it's different in this story, because in the United States it has run the gamut from performances like we saw at the Ice House, where, you know, we're a room full of sympathetic comrades there to gird their loins and here, you know, preach to the choir, go back out and keep up the good work, you know, and standing ovations and cheers.
And that was organized by my group.
Who was that?
Beyond Capitalism Working Group.
Right?
We organized that so that we had all the comments there.
yeah, and it was wonderful. So there's a celebratory festive atmosphere. And that was a lot of what it was like in England as well, because it wasn't a classroom setting, right? The audience was
talking about.
Oh, there we go. There it is. Yes. So it's a different environment. You know, when I do the play in a for you guys at the Ice House, or if I'm performing at a venue in Manchester, it's people who want to go and see it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, in the crowd, I'm sure there are some people who are uninitiated or not quite familiar. Mm-hmm. But when I tour, most of my tour has been to college campuses. And a lot of times I'm on very conservative college campuses. And quite often students know next to nothing about Marx. All they know is that he's bad. They have a very clear idea that he's bad, and they can't believe the stupid professor is making them go to a play about Marx. Mm-hmm. You know, and I can walk into the room and be met with open hostility, because they know that Marx is an atheist and he hates America. And those are my favorite venues. As much as I enjoyed the Ice House, and it's like any actor, I enjoy applause, but the stunned silence of a conservative audience who is now uncomfortable, who is surprised that they're meeting Marx for the first time and they like him.
Some of what he's saying,
you know, they can't believe it, because the question I get a lot after those performances is, that can't be true. And I go, no, it's true. That's the story. They feel like, wow, I just never thought of it. So you see them become very uncomfortable. And I know that even in those most conservative venues, that people will not read the news or experience things in quite the same way anymore. And that is fulfilling. And that's my hope every time I step on stage, is to help someone to stand back and see the bigger picture.
Yeah, I can relate to that, just being a teacher for years and just seeing that, like, maybe aha moment.
Yeah,
facial expression or eyes of a young person who sees things with different eyes, different perspective, and clarifies things for them. Those are very precious moments. For those of you who are joining us a bit late, I'm talking to Bob Weick. He's a wonderful actor, and he performs, among other plays, a one-person play called Marx in Soho, written by the beloved historian, activist, socialist Howard Zinn.
Yeah.
And beside his performance and what he does with horses as a hobby, and I guess making a living as well, he has done something else recently too. I'm going to show this book. Robert has written an introduction to this book with Communist Manifesto and some excerpts from Das Kapital, writings of Engels and Marx. So it's like good company. There's Bob here with Marx and Engels, and he has written that. I know he's not a scholar of Marx, but he's had enough understanding to be able to write an intro to a wonderful book like that.
Right. You know, the public, that was an interesting experience too. And it felt like an honor. And when the publisher first contacted me about it, I was like, no. I said, you know, I thought of you right away. And I thought of Gary Olson. There's another professor, Ariana Fisher, down at Temple, who I felt, now these are the people who, you know, would be the one to do it. And again, no, we don't want that. We don't want that flavor to it. We want, you know, a working class actor guy.
I'm glad
to have this experience and put his perspective on it. And so I felt honored and intimidated by it, and did the best I could with it. And they actually, you know, in some of the drafts, they said, we really need you to just tone it down just a little bit. Could you not? So this is sort of the mildest introduction the mildest draft and the one that they would approve.
So having gone through that, Bob, Does that give you a little bit of a sense of being able to explain better to audiences what the relevance of Marx would be today to our societies or people, to the challenges we face? Who would Marx be speaking to? His voice, his writing?
Yeah. Through the process of writing this introduction, you're wondering if it I'm not sure I understood the question.
Meaning, since you sat down and actually wrote the introduction, maybe right. allowed you to think a bit more carefully about what is the relevance of Marx's ideas to our times. Why should people care about what Marx said and wrote about in the 19th century? We are in 2021. So how would you respond to that? Did you have a chance to think through that a little bit and come up
with an answer? The challenge for us on the left here is always to try to meet people where they are.
Mm-hmm.
And encourage them to come over. It can be very frustrating. Mm-hmm. And it's a relentless challenge because we need people to take these steps to the left, right? To really transform our society and create a just society. To create to do what we can to preserve the planet. So throughout my career as an actor performing Marx, I've always had, a part of that has always been involved with post-play question and answer sessions, with students or visiting classrooms and trying to discuss Marx. I mean, the play itself makes Marx, it humanizes Marx and is a very accessible introduction to him. So the play succeeds on a lot of levels. But as I go around and doing it, I'm always trying to find ways to talk to people about the basic principles of Marx and the basic ideas of capitalism that we need to confront. So I think writing that was, when I think about your question, I think about my insistence that I said to the public, I got to get Bernie Sanders in here. I said, this is a phenomenon. And I made it clear in the introduction that Bernie Sanders is not a Marxist.
Mm-hmm.
Right? He's a New Deal Democrat. He's wearing a socialist badge of honor. He's a social democrat in that tradition, all well and good, but it is showing that the word socialism is no longer the dirty word it once was. It shows this progression. It shows, we're very different from 2004 when I started. We've lived through Occupy in 2010 and 11, right? And the economic crisis of 2008 that led to Occupy and this pandemic. All these things are constantly showing the pitfalls and the failures of capitalism. It's constantly showing, like I tell my liberal friends, capitalism always falls apart. It needs socialism to save it all the time. Why don't we just do the socialism part and forget the crisis part? Why don't we just skip that part, and move right to it? And I'll say, these are the kind of phrases I'll use to try to reach people, I'll say to students, capitalism is based on competition. And in any competition, you have winners and losers. Who in this auditorium wants to be a loser?
Mm-hmm.
Come on, you love capitalism. Somebody's got to lose. Who do you want to assign? Which one of your friends is going to be the loser then? Mm-hmm. Somebody has to lose, right?
Yeah, and not to say anything about exploitation and all that.
Right, and the personal alienation, right?
And wars. I mean, capitalism and wars and imperialism, they all get connected to
climate destruction and racism. Racism and capitalism are bedfellows, right?
So how is your socialism different than, let's say, Bernie Sanders? How would you differentiate your view from his?
My view is sort of that we can't lose sight of the goal that we need a full rupture with capitalist economics.
I mean rupture with capitalist economics. I think you mean that you're talking about not just public ownership of economic activities, but you're probably talking about worker ownership.
Right.
Democratic workplaces run by workers, owned by workers. That would be the kind of revolutionary socialist Marxian idea that I can attest to
you probably have heard of economist Richard Wolff.
Yes.
And his big thing is about worker co-ops.
Yes.
And that's it's the workers of the world unite. It's about no longer having private property, Mm-hmm. It's trying to help people see that the relationship of master and slave and lord and serf and employer and employee is mm-hmm. essentially the same dynamic and same relationship.
Yeah. And by and private property, you mean private productive property. You don't mean people's toothpastes and
not personal property.
Yeah, not personal, productive not property. Yeah.
Right, right. The means of production. The
to make sure our audience doesn't contribute
right. to Now, listen, everyone, you'll get to keep your iPhone. You don't have to worry about
there
that.
You go. You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. That's an important distinction, right? The private property versus personal property. And when Marx uses the word, private property, he's talking about the means of production, essentially. And so the idea is that if these become worker-owned cooperatives and with a more just distribution of the proceeds, you know, mm-hmm. distributed among the workers according to their, from each according to his ability and each according to his need, mm-hmm. you know, so you do away with this competitive race to the bottom and cyclical crises that capitalism has to go through, that socialism, mm-hmm. socialist policies end up saving capitalism yeah. all the time.
Yeah. But do you often end up in conversations with people who oppose your point of view and say things that are pretty conventional about Marx, like, mm-hmm. oh, his ideas are no longer relevant. His ideas are not practical. His ideas lead to dictatorship. Mm-hmm. Other more detailed arguments are like, well, how do you organize production if there is no profit as incentive? You know, mm-hmm. wouldn't that mean everybody becomes lazy? Wouldn't that mean production ceases? Wouldn't that mean poverty gets globalized and socialized? You know, there's all these kind of, you know, old arguments.
Right.
And the arguments from the perspective of owners, like, hey, I risked, it was my idea. I built it. So I must take and I should take, and it's ethical to take from mm-hmm. the wages of workers to myself, mm-hmm. surplus value idea.
Right.
Encounter those objections in your
performance? Sure, you know, yes. I mean, I'm familiar with most of those arguments, and yeah, I've been bludgeoned with them. From time to time. And, you know, I don't pretend to have the exact roadmap. I mean, that's for the working class to chart its course, right? As once we get to the point of class consciousness. Mm-hmm. But what I encourage people to do is I say, well, just look at the world, mm-hmm. at the state of the world. Look at the state of our environment. Do you think we can do better than this? And do you think economics has a role to play mm-hmm. in this history of war and environmental destruction, of genocide, of, you know, throughout the history there's, and things that are going on in the present, we know we can do better. Mm-hmm. And I'll try to get people to, if we can get people to break with the national mythologies that we were all raised with, that that God has blessed us above other nations, and that we are the exceptional and indispensable nation. If I can get people to begin to question even the sanctity of the Constitution, mm-hmm. And to imagine how life could be better mm-hmm. than it is right now, challenge some of the foundations that they were raised to believe. Like, I don't know how many times I'm saying, look, Bob, we're the greatest country in the world. I said, well, how do you measure that greatness? You measure that in bombs? Mm-hmm. You know, do you measure that in carbon output into the atmosphere? Is that how you measure greatness? Is there some other way we can measure the greatness of our society? Mm-hmm. Because the stakes are high. I'm a little far afield here, I think, but I think if we can focus on what if we think of ourselves as I'm a father and I'm a grandfather, and so I'm motivated to continue my work because I've had this love for this next generation that's coming up. Mm-hmm. And if we can step back from the short-term goals and values of capitalism mm-hmm. and think about our responsibility, I think if we can begin to have conversations about what's best for the future, mm-hmm. We can go a long way to challenging the capitalist value system. Mm-hmm. It's a big topic. It's a big question you've asked.
Yeah. I mean, the interest of the elites, the governing elite, the ruling class, the capitalist class, whatever you want to call them, is to make sure that, you know, class consciousness doesn't develop. among ordinary people, among working people. And oftentimes, I think on the left, you hear or I read or we talk to people, you kind of say there's a consensus that there is very little of it, class consciousness among the American workers. And a lot of people then pose questions as to like, why is that? But I think maybe that may be wrong. I'm not sure, but my sense is that I think a lot of people, workers, ordinary workers, know what's up. When they go to work, they know that they're being bossed around. They know that they have stress at work. They know why they have stress. They may even know what an alternative to a workplace that they engage in might be, a better alternative, but they don't see any outlets out there that addresses it. They don't see anyone in the mainstream media, or discourse, or public talking about it. And they certainly haven't been able to express their consciousness to the extent that it exists about class and economic injustice into political expressions, party politics and all that kind of stuff. So I think that's where we are lacking. It's not so much that the American workers don't have class consciousness. It's just that they haven't been able to express it politically. And that's where the left ought to come in. And try to organize people into being able to express their consciousness politically.
I think you're right.
You agree with that? Okay.
I do agree with that. I think, maybe to, if I wanted to quibble, maybe what I see isn't so much a class consciousness as we would understand it as a Marxist, from the Marxist perspective. But there is certainly a dissatisfaction that is running through huge swaths of the working class on both sides of our current political spectrum of liberal and conservative. I saw a recent survey, 64% of Americans feel that the country's, our democratic systems are going to fail, that the nation is failing. It's going to, you know, our aspirations of being a democratic society are failing. And a lot of those, that 64%, are conservatives. You know, so they think it's failing for different reasons. But most people know something is terribly wrong and that it doesn't have to be this way, that we can reorganize our lives and work and to be a much more satisfying and fulfilling experience than what we're having now. And to go back to your point, yes, it seems that the capitalist ruling class is very invested in not letting that happen. So you have these very powerful media forces on both sides pulling at each other and achieving that classic divide and conquer strategy, you know, that we experience.
Yeah,
you know?
But we might be at a historically interesting moment, which is not unparalleled. So we have like parallel historical experiences like this, like let's say Civil War period in the United States, a lot of devastation. And after that, you ended up with a lot of social movements, including the beginnings of labor organizing, which changed, you know, the world, changed the United States, brought all the kind of things that we enjoy today, 8-hour day to the extent that people enjoy 8-hour day or vacations, you know, holidays, social security, all that kind of stuff. In World War II, similarly, you know, when you had like wars, World War I, World War II, in the aftermath of these major events, you had activism. I think we're seeing that now with the pandemic. And the statistics that I, you know, recently read was, for instance, last year, up, you know, around, you know, the last time people looked it up or updated it, about 25% of American workers have quit their job or are looking for different jobs since the pandemic. That's 25% of a very large working class. That's a huge number. At least, you know, the Payday website, which looks at tracks all the worker activism and strikes and sit-ins and stuff, has at least like plus 1,700 plus strikes that it had tracked since March of 2021. So these are moments that we've seen in the past in American history. You have massive disruption and, you know, growth in, you know, consciousness and activism. So it gives me hope. I don't know if you're hopeful, but
Well, there's you know, Howard would always say, we can't give up hope. You got to play the game to the end, you know, and to be foolish, to be hopeful in foolish times isn't being romantic. It knows that history can surprise us. And you're right. I mean, there are lots of evidence. There's been a huge increase in socialist organization since the Sanders campaign. And that understanding and that consciousness is going to deepen. Yeah, and all the labor strikes and the idea of what is essential, who is an essential worker and what are they worth? All those things can come together. So I never want to be falsely optimistic about anything, because there's always a struggle. But I don't think there's anything to do but to continue to support that struggle in whatever way you can.
Yeah, you know? And the ruling elites are not savvy. They're not like, know everything. They're not omniscient. They make mistakes. And I heard just recently that comment that stuck with me that was made by Boot Riley, I think his name is.
Boots Riley, yeah, filmmaker.
Filmmaker that made Sorry to Bother You. He said the ruling class made one of the worst mistakes during the pandemic by calling workers who were needed to go to work essential workers.
When
you name them essential workers, the next time your thought is like, if I'm essential, why am I not being treated?
Right. That's right. Yeah. That's all right.
Needs to be recharged. So I'm just going to
make
sure that doesn't.
And we've got 2 minutes.
Oh, 2 minutes. Okay.
Yeah.
So, if we have 2 minutes, we probably should mention one more topic, which we kind of like did a little bit, but the planet is being killed.
Yeah.
And when you're talking about Marx and socialism and radicalism and, you know, all the other stuff that, you know, young people might be concerned about. I mean, work life, workplaces, exploitation, competition, alienation. But the biggest thing in the room right now, the 800-pound gorilla, is the planet-killing system
that
we have. And we don't have much time to, save the planet. And we can't just be talking about, like, adaptation measures.
Or greenwashing.
Fire walls or something.
Yeah.
At the very least, you would have to have some amelioration. And then, of course, if you're rational, you have to go beyond amelioration and get rid of a system that's doing this, ravaging the planet.
Yeah.
And, Mother Earth had a lot to say about that, too. You know, John Bellamy Foster from Martin Review has written a lot of books about Marx and ecology.
Yeah.
A lot of people should probably check that out, because there's a stereotype of Marx that's productivist, economistic, and pays no attention to nature and wants to, you know, continue the conquest of nature and all that kind of stuff. But John shows that that's a misunderstanding.
Yeah. Yeah. John Bellamy Foster. I have that book. I'll lend it to another professor. Should revisit that. But I maybe because we've got 20 seconds left here.
Okay.
For all its flaws, I would recommend people watch Don't Look Up, the Netflix environmental thing. And it shows that there are problems with the way our system and society is currently organized, that can't meet the challenge.
Absolutely.
So we need to revolutionize society. Let's start today.
I agree. I think, you know, it's a good film to check and watch. I wish they would have spent a little bit more time in terms of people organizing against the system rather than just relying on elites there. But thank you, Bob, for being kind enough to join this conversation. I really appreciated that. And I think the audience does the same too.
Thank you everyone for watching, and I'd be happy to do this again sometime. I feel like there's more we could talk about.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Okay. Thank you.
Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.